eternal God, our Father, we thank you. God, we thank you for this day that you've given us. God, we thank you for another opportunity that you've allowed us to come into the house of God. Father, we thank you for the saints that are present in the room on today. Lord God, our presence here is a testimony of your keeping power, of your healing power, of your goodness, of your kindness, of your mercy. Lord God, our presence here today is a testimony of how faithful you are. In spite of every challenge, in spite of every test, in spite of every attack of the enemy, God, we have become more than conquerors because of you. God, we thank you on today because we recognize there is no God like you. We thank you on today because your goodness and your mercy renews our strength. We thank you on today because morning by morning, new mercies we see. We thank you on today because no matter what happened on yesterday, no matter what happened last week, God, we are here today again to get it right. However we stumbled, however we may have fallen, God, you've given us an opportunity to come back and get it right. So God, hallelujah. God, we ask that you forgive us on this day for sins that we know and sins that we don't know. God, we ask your forgiveness for our inability to be aware of your goodness all the time. God, in this moment, we ask for forgiveness for that moment that we may not have represented you well. God, we ask for forgiveness. And as we move forward, God, we ask that you move us with a clean heart. God, we want to have clean hands on today. We want to enter into your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise. God, we want to give you glory and thanksgiving. We want to give you honor, hallelujah. So God, as we lift you up on today, as we bless your name on today, as we give you glory on today, God, move in this sanctuary. God, move from heart to heart, from breast to breast. God, let your glory saturate the atmosphere. God, we pray for the one that may be discouraged in their spirit. God, we pray that they will be encouraged on today. God, there may be some who are sick in their bodies, but they press their way into the house of God. Father, there's healing in the sanctuary. There's deliverance in the sanctuary. There's help in the sanctuary. There's hope in the sanctuary. God, you dwell in the sanctuary. So God, have your way. God, move in this place. Heal on today, God. Deliver on today, God. Set free on today, God. Save on today. And God, as you move, help us to recognize your glory. As you move, God, we pray for a heart of thanksgiving. As you move, God, we will bless your name. We will give you praise. God, move in the virtual sanctuary on this morning. God, we thank you for their ability to even watch us. God, we thank you for our ability to reach them in their hospital room, in their bedroom, in their kitchen. Lord God, some may be behind bars, but God, you have provided access that they can tap in. So God, we pray that the glory that's in this house will fill their house. We pray that the glory that we experience on today, they will experience on today. God, there are no boundaries with you. You're here, you're there, you're everywhere. So God, show up on today. Have your way on today. God, give us another testimony. Hallelujah, how you brought us out. Give us another testimony of how you made a way. Give us another testimony of how you healed the sick. Give us another testimony of your glory in the earth. And God, we promise that we'll give you all the praise and all the honor in Jesus' name. Can we just bless his name on this morning? Come on, can we bless his name? Hallelujah. I came to bless his name. I came to give him glory. I came to honor and adore him. I will bless your name.
He's worthy of it. Let's lift up the name of Jesus. He's worthy. He is worthy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We come to praise the name of Jesus. He's such a good God. Thank you, Jesus. He's so worthy. He's so worthy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name. lift up a praise to his name. It's not about me, but it's about Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. Thank you, Lord, for waking us up this morning. Thank you, Lord, for keeping us in our right mind. Thank you, Lord, for getting us here safely. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. It's the little things. I just want to say thank you this morning. It's the little things. I just want to say thank you this morning. It could have been another way, but I thank you, Lord. It should have been another way, but I thank you, Lord. I don't deserve it, but I thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 You're worthy, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We offer you praise this morning.
Because you're worthy, Lord,
and we lift our voices. your mercy toward us.
Hallelujah.
For your goodness and your mercy toward us.
Let's hear from y'all singing.
His grace, his mercy, his grace, hallelujah, his grace, he shall tell us about sin, hallelujah. Last couple weeks, I almost was involved in 3 accidents. Always on my way to work, coming down the street, and one guy just went through the stop sign. I was in the middle of going across the intersection, and I had to stop. Next time I'm on my way, and another car just zoomed by. Last week, I was on my way to work. I was 10 seconds away from being hit by a car that was going about 50 miles an hour, went through the stop sign. So his grace, you know what, I thank God that I get up every morning at 4 o'clock in the morning, hallelujah. And I spend 2.5 hours in devotion and prayer. And I thank God that even though these things was happening, God protected me. 3 times. And on my way from an appointment out of town, I always listen to my praise songs. And I was just praising God and worshiping. The next thing I know, I'm in my prayer language. And as I'm praying, it kept saying, God is with you. God is with you. God is with you. Over and over again, God is with you. God is with you. God is with you. And I'm just going down the highway. And all he kept saying was, God is with you. God is with you. God is with you. The next thing I know, I hit a storm. Storm was so bad, I couldn't even see. But I kept hearing, God is with you. God is with you. I had to put on my flashes, had to slow down, but God was with me. He helped me went through the whole storm. Hallelujah. I don't know what you're going through today, but God is with you. I don't know what storm you're going through today, but God is with you. His grace, His mercy, His grace, His goodness, God is with you this morning. Now give God glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said that I won't say. Hallelujah. Glory. It said, oh, come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and make a joyful noise unto him with songs. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. We serve a mighty God this morning. I can't come into the house of the Lord and not lift up my hands. I can't come into the house of the Lord and not say thank you. I can't come out in the house of the Lord and jump for joy. I just can't do it because he's been too good to me. Hallelujah. His goodness and his mercy. Hallelujah. Woo. Hallelujah. You just don't know. Each time that happened, I called my husband. And I told him I almost got in an accident. But God is with me. Even when I'm in on my job, God is with me. Been cussed out, but God is with me. Been talked about, but God is with me. Been lied on, but God is with me. Been troubled sometimes, but God is with me. Been frustrated, but God is with me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We just want to praise God for our Bishop Samuel Hampton II, our Elder Miranda Hampton, Pastor Eugene Wilson, Lady Sarah, Bishop Timothy Bailey and his wife, Evangelist Bailey. And we just thank God. I just thank God for my husband. I just thank God that God looked at me and said, I'm going to send you a good man. I'm going to send you a man that loves you, that takes care of you. And he does. He takes good care of me. Good care of me. And I thank God for my children and their families here this morning. We also thank God for the music ministry, the praises, the worshipers of God, the ushers, and everyone who is serving this morning. We thank God for our Faith Place family. Come on, let's give God glory this morning. And friends, whether you are in the sanctuary or where you are online, hallelujah. We're just going to talk a little bit this morning. I'm not going to give you a time thing because every time people give you time, then they say, we're not going to talk long. They end up talking longer than they said they would. So we're not going to do that this morning. We're going to go straight to the Word of God, and we're going to go to Romans 6 and 4 and Psalms 92, 13 and 14. It says, therefore we bury with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead, by the glory of the Father, even so also should walk in the newness of life. Psalms 92, 13, and 14. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat in flourishing. When people want to be protected or want privacy in their yard, sometimes they put up a fence. How many of us have fences in your yard? Okay, not that many of y'all. Okay, I raised my hand too. Okay, a fence is there to protect them and keep people or things out. Most of the time, they want privacy. Imagine for a moment that you have a sturdy fence marking the boundary between your property and your neighbor's property. You can go outside in your pajamas, you drink your coffee or your tea, drink two or three sweet rolls, and nobody will see you. You can prop up your feet, lie down, take a nap, and nobody will bother you. You are comfortable. You're relaxed. Just like a fence serves to protect, so does our spiritual journey, which resembles the construction of a fence. In Psalms 92 and 13, 14, it says, we are like trees planted in the house of the Lord, flourishing within the confines of his courts. This imagery merits the sturdy posts of a fence, firmly anchored in the soil of God's word in his presence. Just as a fence may encounter obstacles that hinder its purpose, we face barriers on our path to spiritual fruitfulness. The metaphor of a fence is often used to represent the boundaries or limitations placed upon ourselves, consciously or subconsciously. Just as a physical fence marks a boundary separating one area from another, the metaphorical fence positions the comfort zones, the fears, the doubts, and the routines people cling to. These barriers can impede our growth and prevent us from moving beyond the fence of comfort and moving forward to become spiritual fruit bearers in Christ. I want to talk to you today about the fruitful life. I had another subject that I wanted to say, and it was this: break free and bear fruit. Break free and bear fruit. Fruitfulness is mentioned in the Bible from Genesis 1 all the way to Colossians 32 times. Fruitful means to come into being, to bear or bring forth fruit, fertile, producing good or having helpful results, productive. In John 15, 4 and 5, Jesus imparts a profound truth to his disciples, saying this: abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. Ye that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. These words tell us that true abundance and fruitful living comes from being rooted in Christ. Like the branch finds itself having nutrition and vitality in the vine, so do we find our strength and purpose in our relationship with Jesus Christ. Sometimes we remain content when in the confines of our comfort zones, behind the fence we erect around our own lives. We shy away from the challenges of growth, the risk of stepping into the unknown, and the opportunities to bear fruit abundantly. God is calling us to break free from the limitations we impose on ourselves. Break down the fences. He wants us to step beyond the wall of fear and doubt into his grace and provision. Now give God some praise. Hallelujah. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 43 and 19, he says, behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness, in the rivers, in the desert. God promised to make a way where there seems to be no way. In 2 Peter 3 and 9, it says, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise. We have an open invitation to journey journey within uncharted territories where he will guide us and sustain us and enable us to bear fruit that glorify his name. In Psalms 92, once again, 13 and 14, those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall bring forth fruit, hallelujah, in the old days. They shall be fat and flourishing. Flourishing is not surviving. It's thriving abundantly. Flourishing is not surviving. It's thriving abundantly, hallelujah. It's a life marked by growth, fullness, fruitfulness in divine favor. Hallelujah. In God's courts, we find abundant blessings, overflowing joy, profound peace that surpasses all understanding. Even at a mature age, believers will still flourish and bear fruit. Age does not diminish your spiritual vitality. Instead, it magnifies it. Come on and give God praise. Hallelujah. The enemy wants to think because as you get older, God has no use for you. But God has need for you. He has need for you. We need to hear your testimonies. We need to hear about your faith. We need to hear about your life. God has need for you. Don't sit back on the couch and just click, click. Don't sit back. Be used. Be fruitful. Come forth. Get out of the gate. Break down the fence. God needs you. Hallelujah. When we accept Christ as our Savior, we start a life of fruitfulness. However, as we embark on this new life, some barriers may hinder us from partaking in spiritual fruitfulness. What are some of those barriers? One, comfort zones and fear. In Scripture, in Joshua 1 and 9, he said, be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee wheresoever thou goest. And when we look at Psalms 27 and 1, it says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? God encourages us not to fear or be dismayed as we step outside of our comfort zone. His presence goes with us wherever we go, providing strength and courage, hallelujah. When fear grips our heart, grapes or grabs or just want to just take you and hold you as a hostage, our hearts and hold us back from stepping beyond our comfort zone. I just hear, takes us as a hostage. Where we in our comfort zone and we are held hostage because we are too afraid of going beyond the gate. We are being held hostage. And all we have to do is kick down the gate. Don't allow Satan to hold you hostage. The Bible says God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. He calls us to be strong and courageous, trusting in his presence and his promises. We have power in the Holy Ghost. But ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Then why are we held hostage? Why can't we move? Why can't we do what God has called us to do? The Bible says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. We have to speak to whatever is holding us hostage. Jesus said, because he was talking to the disciples, because of your unbelief, I verily I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove. And guess what he says? In nothing shall be impossible unto you. He said, nothing. Tell your neighbor, nothing. 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 Nothing shall be impossible unto you. Nothing. Whatever barrier that's holding you, you have the power to get yourself free. Because you have to just speak to it. And he said, nothing shall be impossible unto you. Another barrier, our routine. Some of us people can bet on you and know exactly where you're going to be at any given time, because they know your routine. You do the same thing every day. Every day, same thing. You drink the same coffee. You have the same meal. You eat at the same restaurant. Routine, routine, retune. God said he's doing something new. Change. Try something different. Go to a different restaurant. Go a different way to work. Try tea. Try a smoothie. It's okay. It's not going to hurt you. But it's going to help you get out of that routine. Stagnation. A routine is a sequence of actions regularly follow a fixed program. Now, you ought to know, when you're following God, it's not a fixed program. It's a venture. It's excitement. And stagnation, the state of not flowing or moving, lack of activity, growth, or development. Have you seen that commercial where people are in potato suits and they're out in a field and they talking about TV and their channels? Why would I be outside in a field talking about channels? But they're in their comfort zone, and God is saying, I want you out of it. I want you to break free. You've been stagnant long enough. You had the same routine long enough. It's time for a change. It's time for something new. The Bible says in Isaiah 43:18-19, he said, remember ye not the former things, neither consider things of old. Behold, I would do a new thing, now shall spring forth, shall ye not know it? He says, I will even make a way in the wilderness, in the rivers, in the desert. I read that before, but I read it again because I want you to remember that God is doing a new thing. In Romans 12:2, he said, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. But if I was to read the Amplified version, it would say this, and do not be conformed to this world any longer with its superficial values and customs, but be transformed and progressively changed as you mature spiritually by renewing of your mind, focusing on godly values and ethical attitudes, so you may prove for yourself what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect in his plan and purpose for you. God wants us to be fruitful. God challenges us to let go of the past. Embrace the new things he's doing in our lives. He promised to make a way where there seems to be no way. To bring on new opportunities in growth. In Ecclesiastes 3:1, it says this. There's a time for everything. To everything there is a season, including seasons of change and new beginnings. We must recognize those barriers that stop us from becoming spiritual fruit bearers in Christ. What else should we do? Growth barriers. Oh, boy. We really got to talk about that. Growth barriers. What the enemy does to keep you hostage is to keep you from not reading your word. He gets you so busy that you can't read a scripture. But you grow by the word. So one of the barriers is not reading the word. There are too many programs, too many ministries, and I call them buffet ministries. Because they only serve you what they want. They're not going to serve you what you need. They're only going to serve you what they think that you want to hear. So they're not going to tell you about sin. They're not going to tell you about living holy. They're not going to tell you that fornication is wrong. They're not going to tell you that adultery is wrong. But they will tell you that God will give you everything that you want. All you have to do is just speak and then it shall happen. But see, with buffet ministries, you don't grow. Because you're not getting the right food. You have to take the good with the bad. Just as parents, we love our children. But there are times when we will have to discipline our children. It's not like we enjoyed it. Okay, but we know that we didn't discipline them, okay, that they will go the other way. So sometimes this may cause for a spanking, okay, or punishment, or take away the phone. Because, see, God said he loves who he chastises. And sometimes we get chastised. Okay, we get put in line sometimes because we're out of order sometimes. So God got to bring us back so we can grow, so we won't get cut off. See, he got to prune you. He got to cut them branches. Why? So you can have more fruit. Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthened me. Philippians 3:13-14 says, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. In Romans 8:31, it says, what shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? You got to break down the fence. You got to break free. Because with God on your side, nobody can whip you. Nobody. Paul encouraged us to press forward and not be hindered by past failures or limitations. Our focus should be on the goal ahead. Hebrews 12:1 says, urges us to lay aside every weight and sin that hinders us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. When obstacles and barriers threaten to impede our growth, let us adopt that mindset of Apostle Paul. Pressing forward with determination and perseverance, though we may face setbacks and challenges, we must refuse to be defined by our past mistakes or our present limitations. I know you, this is probably what you don't want to hear. But people have told me, I don't come to listen to you because you're always on my toes. Well, then you need to live right. We must understand with God's strength and guidance, we can overcome every barrier in our life and continue to move in fruitfulness. This is about fruit. This is about abundance. Galatians 5:22-23 says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. As we yield to the Holy Spirit, let the Holy Spirit work in your life. Let him be the guide, not you. You don't even know where you're going. So how you gonna take yourself somewhere? You don't even know where you're going. We are to trust in his transformative work in our lives and allow his fruit to manifest in our attitudes, our actions, our relationships, that it will bring glory to him and it will bless other people. The Bible says in Matthew 7:16-20, and I'm not going to read all of it. It says, even so, every good fruit bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewed down and cast into the fire. Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall what? Know them. You want to know a person, look at their fruit. Is it good or is it evil? Is it helping others or is it bringing pain? Take heart in the assurance that your life has the potential to impact others for eternity through its fruit it bears. Your life, your testimony can draw others to Christ. Your testimony. People don't testify anymore. But the Bible tells us you overcome by your testimonies. I'm wrapping up here soon. I'm going to skip that one. But it's okay. Let's look at the word when we talk about the spiritual fruit bearers. Paul, the apostle, he exemplified bearing fruit in Christ through his prolific missionary journeys. Planting churches, spreading the gospel throughout the Roman Empire. He also displayed various spiritual gifts such as preaching, teaching, and apostleship. Dorcas, also known as Tabitha, was known for her acts of charity and kindness, especially making garments for the widows in her community. She demonstrated the fruit of kindness in the spiritual gift of serving others. And it was Barnabas. He was the companion of Paul. He was known for his encouragement and his generosity. He sold his land to support the early Christian community in Jerusalem. And he played a significant role in mentoring and supporting new believers. Now tell me, what are you going to do in the house of God? Stephen, one of the first deacons in the early church, was known for his faithfulness, his wisdom, his bold statements about the gospel. He was full of the Holy Spirit, and he performed what? Great wonders and signs among the people. And then it was Peter. Peter was one of Jesus' disciples, demonstrating the spiritual gift of leadership and evangelism. He boldly preached the gospel on the day of Pentecost, leading what? Thousands to repentance and baptism. These are just some examples of fruit bearers. Doesn't matter how old you are, whether you're young, you're middle aged, you're old, God still has need for you. I was reading an article where a young man, he was in his teens, and he read something that somebody needed help. And what he did, he gathered up and took his social media stuff and started sending out messages to people to come help this other person. And they got together and they helped this person. God has need of you. How do we live a life of fruitfulness? One, abide in Christ. Develop an intimate relationship with Christ through prayer. And people don't want to pray now. We've been beyond that now, lay me down to sleep stuff. We've been beyond Jesus wept when you get ready to eat. We need some praying folk. We need people who are going to face down, who are going to lay prostrate before God. We got too many things going on in families, and we know about it, and we do nothing. We are responsible to pray when we hear things going on. That's our responsibility. Studying his word, fellowshipping with other believers. Just don't come to church and go home. Get to know somebody. You never know when you're going to need help. You never know when somebody, you're going to need somebody to pray for you. You just come in church, sit down, give your offering out the door. Say hello sometimes. Praise the Lord sometimes. How you doing sometimes? I did not say you got to take him out to lunch. I did not say you got to buy him something. All I'm saying is speak. And that costs you nothing. Seek the filling of the Holy Spirit. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. That's rough on a lot of people. You can believe God, but in order for you to get into the family, you got to have his Spirit. And the Bible says, and be not drunk with wine, whereas in excess, but be filled with the Spirit. You got to be filled. If you have not spoken in tongues in a long time, it's time to be filled. Because maybe there's some barriers in there that's stopping that from going forth. And we have to go forth. And I'm going to have to wrap up. We have to go forth. Hallelujah, because I don't want anybody getting upset with me. But I had two more pages, but I'm getting ready to wrap this up because it's important. It's important for you in 2024. Bishop had already set out the mantle what we're supposed to do. We are not supposed to be like we were last year. We are not what we're supposed to be like we were in January. January, we are not what we're supposed to be last week. We have to keep growing. And yes, it's uncomfortable. It's uncomfortable. When God shows you who you are, it's uncomfortable. But he wants you to bear fruit. He wants you to bear fruit. So he wants you to be free. He wants you to be free. Say free.
Free.
Free. I mean, say it like you really want to be free.
Free.
That, see, that's a little bit better. A little bit better. But remember this. The thief come not but for to steal and to kill and destroy. I am come that they might have life, that they might have it more abundantly. God desires abundant life for us. a life marked by spiritual fruitfulness and fulfillment. I invite you to come to the altar, and we will pray with you. Lay down your fears, your doubts, and your limitations before the Lord. Let him refresh you with his spirit. Let him empower you so you can bear fruit, and that you will glorify his name and bless those around you. If you have not decided to follow Christ as your Lord and Savior, I ask you not to let this moment pass by. The fence of sin separates you from the abundant life that God offers. You have the opportunity today to step into the life of freedom, forgiveness, and eternal hope. God loves you. He loves you. But he also wants you to be fruitful. Now let's give God praise. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's thank the Lord on today for his word. Amen. We thank God for his word, and we've made up in our minds we're going to be fruitful. Amen. Amen. As we prepare ourselves, we're getting ready for consecration starting on Monday. Consecration starts on Monday. And so we'll have our time of prayer and fasting as we continue to go before the Lord. So I'm asking everyone that's able to join us as much and often as you can. Prayer be here in the sanctuary from 12 to 1, Monday through Friday, 7 to 8, Monday through Friday. On Thursday, we will do communion. On Thursday in our 12 noon and 7 p.m. service, we'll have communion, and we're going to do our very best for those who join us online to stream as much as we possibly can, that you might be able to participate. But it's nothing like being in the building. Amen. Amen. Before we get ready to give and to have our benediction, I want to ask Deacon and Sister Williams to come, as we want to bring in a new family into membership on today. So we want to thank the Lord for Brother Michael and Sister Maria Solomon. If they'll come on down. Amen. Let's thank the Lord for them on today. They got their granddaughter with her. All right. Amen. Amen. And we thank God for them on today.
Brother Solomon, your family, do you wish your family become a member of the First Apostolic Faith Church?
Yes.
Do you promise before the First Apostolic Faith Church to live a life of holiness according to the Bible by the help of the Lord?
Absolutely.
Upon the recommendation of our pastor and your own expressed desire, it's my privilege to welcome you to the fellowship of the First Apostolic Faith Church. Let us work together to glorify God. Kind grace, let us receive our family here. God bless you. Praise the Lord, Sister Solomon. How are you today? You wish to become the First Apostolic Faith Church. Do you promise before the First Apostolic Faith Church to live a life of holiness according to the Bible by the help of the Lord?
Yes, I do.
Upon the recommendation of our pastor and your own expressed desires, my privilege to welcome to the fellowship of the First Apostolic Faith Church, where we work together to glorify God. Congregation, let us receive Sister Solomon by saying, amen. God bless you.
Amen. Amen. Dr. Nolan said, now talk to somebody. So make sure you greet them. Make sure you let them know that they're joining us, each and every person that is joining us. So we're preparing our hearts. I'm going to ask, as our trustees come and prepare our time of giving on today, I'm going to ask Elder Lewis if you will come, Evangelist Johnson if you will come, amen, Elder Miranda if you will come, amen. Hey, Pastor Leland, I know you're playing, but if you'll come and get a bottle of oil for me and help me on today, amen. We're going to anoint you as you come around, as we prepare to go in the time of consecration. We're going to anoint you on today as you prepare. And so as you're coming around and giving, they will anoint you. And our anointing is just a part of our stepping into what God is doing during this time of consecration. And so as you're coming around, amen, those that come around, each and every section. They'll just anoint you. And so don't be in too much of a hurry. Amen. Let them anoint you as you come around on today. Also, I want to remind you at 5 o'clock p.m., we have an Abraham of Temple Archdiocese. We are having a fellowship service here at 5 o'clock p.m. Churches are coming in near and far. And so if you're able to join us back here on tonight at 5 p.m., I want you to come out and have a glorious time as we worship the Lord together. Our speaker will be Pastor DeJell Solomon, so I'm excited to hear what God has given him. Let us all stand at this time as we prepare ourselves to pray and then to give as we get ready for Christian education start immediately after we finish here. But if you do need special prayer, the ministers will be here at the altar to pray with you. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you and praise you on today for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you for your loving kindness. We thank you for your many blessings. Lord, as we lay hands on each and every one of these prayer requests, those that have come in, Lord God, hallelujah, over social media, those that have come in through our website, Father, we lift them up right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray for those in the hospital, those who are recovering at home, those in the nursing home. Father, we believe and know that you are a healer and you are our chief physician. So, Father, touch right now is our prayer. Comfort and strengthen is our prayer. And we thank you for it now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. I'm going to ask you to turn towards our Easter Avenue exit. The ushers will bring you around from the rear. As you come around, come and give cheerfully unto the Lord. We say thank you to all of our guests that have joined us. And I pray you will continue to join us and make the faith place your home church. Well, amen. As you're coming around.